Every child is born a pioneer. You and I, each of us at birth, begin at zero in certain ways. We each face frontiers of the mind, learning to make meaning of the world as we experience it through our senses. Only you can see your own personal frontiers. No parent or teacher can see what you see. Not even you can see what novelty will emerge in the next moment, the next day, the next epoch of your life. Alone on frontiers, pioneers value self-reliance above all. But we also face frontiers together, frontiers of knowledge, technology, culture, and changing institutions. Together on frontiers, pioneers value community above all, fellowship, compassionate support, and shared resources. Today's children meet burdens and joys of pioneering that differ in two ways from those of the past. First, our children are pioneering on more frontiers than ever before. And second, they're born into a society more complex in other ways, too. Greater depth of knowledge and technology, greater span of worldviews, and greater distances between extremes. So today's children are blessed and cursed to inherit a world that is both broader and deeper, more frontiers to be aware of, and more to be aware of on each frontier. Compared to earlier generations, kids today must depend less on their parents' understanding of the world and more on their own ability to navigate without even a good map. Their happiness, fulfillment, and productive engagement in society depend more on skills of pioneering than ever before. Today's worldscape makes correspondingly greater demands on our pioneering children, some on each child alone, and some on their generation together. Individually, for example, children find greater demands on their cognitive, emotional, and moral faculties. Together as a new generation, they experience greater demands on their powers of collaboration and cooperation, demands for accommodation of differences and reconciliation of differences. Schools are not meeting the need, and some of the reasons are in plain sight. For decades, scientists and researchers have been consolidating discoveries about how children grow, how the mind develops, and how societies evolve. Contrary to decisive evidence, schools are not adopting the fundamental changes indicated. We're stuck. Education policy is stuck in politics, money, and inertia. Pioneers need self-reliance, supportive community, and access to knowledge, technology, and society. Sadly, most schools undermine self-reliance, neglect community, and severely limit access to technology and society. Self-directed democratic schooling proves an alternative that is more satisfying and fulfilling for students, for educators, and for society. That alone is compelling. Evidence from science and scholarship makes it even more so. But the real kicker is this. Democratic schools are self-renewing, systematically adaptive to ongoing changes in the larger world beyond school. For this reason, democratic schools are less likely to become brittle institutions bent on self-perpetuation despite explosive dissonance such as we see in schools today. This is what I hope to show you. I propose to do it in four steps. First, I'll talk about culture wars, an ongoing contest for control of public policy. I'll talk about historical roots, why it won't go away ever, and how our children might deal with it. Next, I'll talk about how children develop. Decades of knowledge accumulated by thousands of researchers offers profound insights. Next, I'll talk about three movements in schooling. We'll see parallels in the stages of growth in culture, in children, and in schooling. Last, I'll compare two ways of structuring schools, the curriculum classroom control model and the self-directed democratic model. And of course, I'll recommend that we take the upgrade. When Melissa first invited me to speak, she suggested that I address the relevance of self-directed democratic education in the world today. Later, amidst pregnancy, childbirth, and motherhood, Melissa yielded to reason, and Larry took over management of this project. He asked me for the title of my talk, and here's what I gave him. I said, "Every Child a Pioneer, Fourth Order Schooling on the New Frontier." I don't think he liked it. He said it was too long, but I think he was also suspicious of the term fourth order. I think he saw it as a talk about intervention from the fourth dimension or maybe a conspiracy involving militia in the foothills. But relax, Larry. I offered him the word integral instead of fourth order, but he didn't like that one either. The idea of fourth order or integral is about small changes accumulating to the point of utter transformation. At some point, you realize the world has changed. That's happening today in institutions, the economy, cultural values, and even in personal ways of seeing and thinking about the world. You'll see why I call it fourth order, but if you think it should be third or fifth or something else, I won't quibble. The point is that sooner or later, it's a new era. In a layered world, it's good to remind ourselves that there are many ways to see truth, many ways to make meaning and find order. So to put us in a good frame for looking at culture wars, a frame of mind for finding some truth in every perspective, I want to give you a little survey about yourself. I'm going to read three statements, and I want you to mentally select the one that fits you best. A, I am always right and wise. I see the world with perfect clarity. B, I'm always wrong and unwise. I see the world with no clarity at all. C, sometimes I'm right, sometimes wise, sometimes wrong, sometimes unwise. So choose the one that fits you best. And if you chose statement C, please raise your hand. Thank you. That's the one, of course, that we expect everybody or most people to choose. Sometimes I'm right, sometimes wise. The point is that nobody's 100% right. Nobody's 100% wrong. Everybody is partially correct. Or another way of saying that is that every perspective reflects some truth. And I think you'll also agree that the world includes today a multitude of perspectives. In that frame of mind, let's look at three perspectives that dominate the public sphere today, competing for control of public policy, traditional, modern, and postmodern. I want to quickly review and summarize each. The traditional era and worldview emerged thousands of years ago and is associated with agrarian economies. The traditional worldview survives today, for example, in world religions, military culture, and conservative ideology. Historically, traditional societies have organized around rigid hierarchies such as feudalism and empires. Each era and worldview innovates ways of seeing the world and making meaning of it, and a set of values. Traditional values include faith, duty, civic honor, law and order, noble self-sacrifice. Notice that traditional values are alive and well today and are invoked often. And notice, too, that most people hold these values to some degree. Each era and worldview also produces extremes or distorted expressions of itself. Traditional perspectives can tend towards the intolerant, dogmatic, and literalist. The modern era and worldview emerged roughly 400 years ago at a time of Renaissance and Enlightenment when Galileo first looked through his telescope and said, in effect, "Look, each of us can see the world through our own eyes. We don't need the church to tell us how nature works. I can see the moons of Jupiter for myself." It was the rise of individual empowerment, leading eventually to revolutions and mass democracies. The modern era blossomed into science, technology, and the Industrial Revolution. Today, modernism continues to be most associated with industrial economy. The modern worldview dominates today in asserting its values of science, progress, achievement, individual merit, and more. Taken to extreme, modern tends to be materialistic, unscrupulous, exploitive, particularly in corporate excesses. Now notice some general properties of stage transitions. Earlier forms remain. Traditional values and institutions persist into the modern era and indefinitely into the future. Later builds on earlier. The modern era emerged from and builds on traditional. No known culture has ever been born at modern. All have passed through something that looks like traditional. Each stage can be seen as a reaction to or opposition to the stage that it follows. Arguably, for example, the modern era with its individualism emerged in opposition to brutal repressions of the traditional era. Emergent novelty. Each stage brings unpredictably new developments in many ways and also expanded possibility. Each new view, each new version of the world tends to increase the possibilities, the degrees of freedom to act. The summary is transcend and include. Each stage transcends and includes its predecessors, some essence of what came before. Successive stages tend to be expansive, enlarging the culture, the worldview, or as we'll see later, the child. Postmodern worldview is recent in history. Postmodernism can be seen as a reaction to and pushback against modernism. It's associated primarily with the information age and a services economy. Some of what postmodernism pushes back against is modernism's exploitation, materialism, and abuse of power. Postmodernism tends to be much more egalitarian and more oriented to the group than to the individual. The joke in business circles is that a modern business meeting is successful if it produces action plans, but a postmodern business meeting is successful if everybody shares. Where a modern perspective values majority rule, postmodern tends to value consensus. Postmodern also reintroduces spirituality in new forms, while sharing with modern a rejection of traditional religion. Today's wave of narcissism is commonly seen as a postmodern development, and taken to extreme, postmodern tends to be so egalitarian that it rejects any sort of hierarchy and visible leadership. Postmodernism can also tend to be so accepting of diversity that it withholds all moral judgment, asserting that the only valid assessment of morality is against a culture's norms. Now you can begin to see room for a next stage or a fourth order or an integral worldview. I'm suggesting an emerging worldview that transcends and includes these three. A worldview that today's 20-somethings are already living and forging. It's the first worldview that accommodates its predecessors, wishing each the freedom to live and express its values without imposing those values on all of society. I call it fourth order or integral. My daughter says it's too soon to call it that. She thinks that it may not represent a stage beyond postmodern. She thinks maybe postmodern just hasn't ripened yet and it will morph into what I'm calling fourth order or integral. We'll see. The labels don't matter, the differences do. To summarize about culture wars, if each stage had a rallying cry, for traditional it might be truth, for modern it might be reason, for postmodern it might be compassion. Among American adults, the estimates are that about 40% are most comfortable in traditional perspectives, but this is my reminder that we classify perspectives, not people. The truth is that we all hold a blend of perspectives and values. changing over time and changing in context. So, for example, you might be most comfortable with traditional values when it comes to matters of home and family. You might be more comfortable with modern values in the workplace, and perhaps postmodern values in spirituality. Estimates are that about a quarter of the American adult population are most comfortable in the modern perspective and about 15% in postmodern. Another interesting estimate is that about 20% of the wealth and power, the influence on public policy, is controlled by traditional perspectives. About 50% by modern and 20% by postmodern. The modern turf is where public policy debates are carried out. We cite scientific research and scholarly studies because our social agreement is that public policy should be guided by objective evidence rather than intuition, feelings, or faith. Traditional and postmodern both go along with this, even though their heart may lie elsewhere. So, for example, religionists crafted the theory of intelligent design in the language of science for public policy debate, but the passion behind it was traditional faith-based. Each of these perspectives seeks to impose itself on all. Modernism dominates today, opposed by traditional and postmodern, which also oppose one another. Three frontier conditions are represented here. First, there are more perspectives now contending in the public dialogue than at any time in the past. Second, we can be sure that the future is bringing still more, perhaps a fourth very soon, even while these three remain. And third, recent layers continue to ripen and complexify. Traditional and modern and passion remain on the scene, modern and postmodern in particular, continuing to develop. Let's talk about layers of mind. The mid-20th century brought a revolution in understanding of how children develop and launched the entire field of developmental psychology. The basic theory of stage development in children is well established now and paints a very messy picture. At birth, you start at zero and advance in small steps along meandering pathways. Sometimes you advance rapidly, sometimes slowly, and sometimes you go backwards, you regress. Over time, though, you tend to spiral upwards, solidifying earlier stages on which to build later stages and becoming more capable. Making it even messier, the process takes place simultaneously along numerous lines of development, such as verbal, social, mathematical, physical, musical, and so on. Maybe you've heard of Howard Gardner's multiple intelligences, each of which can be viewed as a somewhat independent line of development. Each is a frontier of learning and growth. Here I'm suggesting some very general stages of consciousness, which I'll describe briefly, mostly in terms of cognitive line of development, made famous by Jean Piaget, a founding figure in developmental psychology. It's important to note that the correlations to age here, infant, toddler, and so on, are only broad generalizations to be taken with a grain of salt. Each child develops with unpredictable timing, and most people's development slows down or plateaus at some point in each line of development. Infants start out in an oceanic consciousness, a bundle of undifferentiated sensory inputs. Over time, the infant finds patterns and organizes the stimuli to make meaning from them. For example, an infant may randomly grab and bite their toe and experience pain. With repetitions, the infant comes to understand the toe as part of themselves. They understand the difference between me and the rest of the world, the skin boundary. That's pretty basic learning. But that's the starting point for each of us, zero meaning until we figure it out on our own terms. I'm calling the next stage magic consciousness. The child doesn't fully differentiate between what's in their mind and what has physical presence. And they also don't get that each person has a separate stream of experience. So, for example, maybe you've played hide and seek with maybe a one-year-old, and when it's their turn to hide from you, what do? They may, yes, they cover their eyes, and they may even say, "You can't see me." Because they can't see you, and they can't separate what's in their mind from any other reality, they think you can't see them. In the magic mind, what you imagine can be real in the same way as physical objects have reality. And that can be terrifying, of course, to experience your imagination as physical reality, which is partly why toddlers are prone to nightmares. That also makes magic real. When that amusing adult pulls a penny from behind your ear, in your own experience, that's as real as anything else. I think fascination with dinosaurs often begins when a child is straddling the magic and mythic stages or going back and forth. The fear of monsters, imagined monsters, is still very real and fresh, but now they know it's only in their own mind, and in that sense, they've prevailed over the monsters. They've gained power over fear. Two comments here. First, you don't move from one stage to the next cleanly. It's back and forth, leaps and falls, tiny steps, twisting pathways, and it's different for each person. Second, we retain some ability to experience our past stages and states of mind. I enjoy magic shows, and I think it's because I'm tapping into the delight of my child mind. In the mythic stage, children tend to think concretely. For example, if you give a kid who is thinking in this stage three blocks of different colors, and you ask them how many different ways can they line them up, like red, green, blue, they'll line them up one way, and then they'll randomly line them up another way, and they'll keep doing that. But in the next stage, in the rational stage, they'll approach it more methodically. Maybe they'll put the red one first and then try each combination that begins with red and then move on. They'll think through an abstract methodology and be able to implement it. The rational stage is distinguished in the cognitive line of development by the ability to think abstractly in terms of principles and ideas. Many kids reach this stage around adolescence, and it transforms their sense of self-identity. In mythic, kids tend to think of themselves in terms of their physical body and their role in family. Around adolescence, identity tends to shift to the mental realm of self-image and also to peer group relations. Personal appearance becomes more important at this stage, what they wear, for example. They create an abstract idea of themselves, a self-image, and try it on mentally and socially. They enter a world of ideas, and they become idealistic. They begin to look at the physical and social worlds in terms of principles. Sometimes the result is a heightened sensitivity to social justice, environmental care, and other issues of principle. I want to mention Maslow's hierarchy of needs briefly here, which can be viewed as a developmental sequence. The idea is that you must satisfy basic needs, such as food, shelter, and belonging, before you are concerned with higher needs such as achievement, understanding, beauty, justice, wisdom. Maslow's hierarchy can be correlated with other lines of development as the needs that are generally the focus of concern at each stage. In each line of development, satisfaction at each stage uncovers new challenges, which then become the new focus. Much like in the stages of culture, you sort of push off one stage into the next. Reacting to perceived deficiencies or resolving dissonance. You rearrange your mental furniture and you start seeing the world differently. We are itchy creatures, we human beings. And each time we scratch an itch to satisfaction, we become aware of a new one somewhere else. Life is a whack-a-mole game of itches. The itch is a provocation, an opportunity for self-authorship. Scratching can be the exercise of human volition. It's the exercise of what's often called agency, the capacity to act on one's behalf, a vital capacity. Stage transitions in human development share essential properties with cultural stage transitions. Earlier forms remain. Abstract thinking augments concrete thinking, but you don't lose the ability to think concretely. Later builds on earlier, novelty emerges, and the possibilities are expanded. There's a greater range of action, expanded possibilities for things to go wrong or right. The summary is that each stage includes what's there and transcends it. I want to mention multiple intelligences again. Made famous by Harvard researcher Howard Gardner, it reflects the common sense idea that people can be smart in many different ways. Gardner originally identified 8 intelligences shown here: interpersonal, logical, mathematical, verbal, linguistic, musical, rhythmic, bodily, kinesthetic, naturalistic, and intrapersonal. Some people have tried to label children to one intelligence or another, but most agree that each person uniquely blends all of the intelligences. Nobody knows exactly how many lines of development there are, but the best guesses seem to be a dozen or two. That is, these are capacities that reflect biologically distinct origins and partially dependent or fully dependent developmental pathways. Some of them appear to be dependent on one another. So, for example, development of empathy depends at least partly on development of cognitive skills such as the ability to project and predict another person's thoughts and feelings. A little bit more about lines of development. Early interpretations of Piaget's work believed that stages were crisply defined and experienced, that there was just one line of development, and that children followed that line in the same sequence of steps at about the same age. That was a convenient distortion, because it lends itself to an industrial metaphor of education, which is very appealing to the modern perspective. Schools are factories. Ignorant children are the raw materials, and standardized young adults are the product. The raw materials are treated by a standard process and subjected to quality control, testing. Teachers are the machines used to bend, fold, and spindle the raw materials into the desired shape. But again, development is very messy, which is something science has known for decades. Parents have known it since forever. Children are not simply located in a stage. They switch up modes of consciousness, sometimes in an instant, sometimes from day to day, unevenly and erratically across lines of development. So, we all start at 0 in each line of development, and we develop at different rates in different lines of development. We grow fast in some lines, slow in others, we speed up and slow down, we go backwards, we go in circles, and there's no predicting how it's going to unfold. How does stage growth occur? Let's look at a learning cycle. There you are, humming along in blue stage in some line of development. The sun is shining and all is well. Along comes something unexpected and things don't seem quite right. You experience dissonance, even though you may not acknowledge it consciously or have any clue about where it's coming from. A bolt of insight strikes, perhaps in a flash, or sometimes slowly over months or even years. Sometimes it takes a lot of repetition. You rise to a higher level of functioning and consolidate those gains. The sun comes out, you're happy, and you go right on your way. Well, not quite, of course. If you're like most of us, it takes many repetitions and much dissonance before you consolidate, stabilize, and reliably operate the new software. You've got to work out the bugs, and you are your own programmer. Development is all about self-authorship, writing your own unique story. Okay, this is one of 3 pivotal moments in my talk, and this is going to be on the test, so pay attention. I want to look more closely at that dissonance. I've tagged it with a storm cloud, but that may be misleading because dissonance isn't bad or good. And it isn't external. We often grow from adverse external events, such as an injury or losing a job or a fight with a friend. Adverse events can certainly precipitate dissonance, but dissonance arises internally, even when outward circumstances are fine. For example, consider that child who covers their eyes and thinks nobody can see them. Well, at some point, they notice that others do see them, and that creates dissonance. The child's worldview has been disturbed. Their mental model of the world, their understanding of how things work, doesn't match experience. That's dissonance. It's an existential challenge. It's an irritation of being, an itch that must be scratched. Every living creature experiences dissonance and the need to resolve it. Biologists call it irritability, and it's a hallmark of life. In human creatures, the capacity to act consciously on one's own behalf is called agency. Healthy agency is crucial to survival and development. It's what scratches in response to an itch. Each line of development essentially represents a series of existential challenges that arise spontaneously from the current conditions of human existence. It's a bit like a video game. You beat one level, and you find yourself in a new level with new challenges. The challenge and stimulation to grow is built into us. Simply by being human, you are destined to itch. So you might as well get good at scratching. Okay, that ends the first of three pivotal moments. I'll let you know when the second one arrives. I want to talk now about layers or stages in education. In traditional schooling, the aim is to transmit knowledge. Teaching methods include drill and practice, rote memorization, recitation. Children are regarded as empty vessels, and education is the process of filling those vessels. Teachers are the source of knowledge and discipline. The guiding metaphor is fill a bucket. In modern schooling, the aim is to stimulate insights that build knowledge. Instead of conveying facts by telling you, modern wants to convey insights by having you do things. Instead of simply obeying, modern wants you to think. The guiding metaphor is light a fire. Okay, here comes the second of those three pivotal moments. What exactly distinguishes modern schooling from traditional? It's a discovery about how people learn. You can't insert knowledge into a mind. Each person has to construct the knowledge. That's the word they use, construct. Maybe this seems obvious to you, but it wasn't always. And it is truly an important discovery leading to radical transformation of teaching in schools. You can't pour knowledge into me. I have to build it myself using my own body, heart, and mind. Knowledge is not a substance. It's the result of a process. It's the result of doing and thinking. With acceptance of this discovery, teaching methods had to change. Modern teaching strives to inspire the student to engage in a process that leads to the insights prescribed in the curriculum. Teachers must get students not simply to obey, but to think, because thinking is an essential part of the process. Thinking is necessary to construct knowledge. The quintessential modern teaching method is guided discovery. Students follow a series of steps in, say, a science experiment and discover for themselves that magnets attract or repel one another, or gravity accelerates a ball on a slope. This was truly a phenomenal innovation and improvement. And that concludes the second pivotal moment. Before we move on, notice that the leap from traditional schooling to modern schooling exhibits the same properties as other stage transformations. So the earlier forms remain. In modern schooling, modern schooling draws on traditional teaching and learning practices, taking the best of the innovations from the past. Deeper understanding of learning brings novel teaching methods which expand the possibilities. And again, modern schooling transcends but includes traditional schooling. Integral schooling transcends both traditional and modern. Where's postmodern in this table, you might ask? The column labeled modern here incorporates both modern and postmodern. In postmodern schooling, the model is essentially the same as in modern, but the content differs. What happened is that schools are controlled locally by school boards, and those school boards generally reflect whatever perspective is dominant in the geographic area they serve and control. So the values and content tend to be modern in some places, postmodern in others, and a mix in most, but following the same curriculum classroom control structure of schooling. Postmodern teaching, as an example of a difference, would probably make more use of group projects and would tend to emphasize community service, social justice, probably environmental sensitivity. But again, the two employ the same basic structure. Modern and postmodern schooling rest on the insight that we each construct knowledge. In a modern, postmodern classroom, a skilled teacher lights a fire to stimulate thinking and insight, which builds knowledge. Then the teacher lights another fire to stimulate the next insight in the curricular sequence. And then time's up, or the bell rings, and the subject changes to something else. The same teacher, or in older grades, maybe a different teacher in a different room, then lights a fire to stimulate thinking about another subject. And then the teacher lights another fire, and so on. Meanwhile, for me, a student, there's a fire burning in me, several, in fact, but dang, they're not about this particular subject. For me, it's about something else entirely at the moment. And meanwhile, for me, another student, I've been here, done this. That fire was hot a while ago, but not now. And meanwhile, for me, yet another student, ain't no firewood in sight. I have no idea what this teacher's talking about. Let me unpack this a little bit. Oh, and this is, we've arrived at the third of three pivotal moments here. So first of all, yes, we each construct our own knowledge, and we want to hold on to that insight and carry it forward into integral schooling. There are actually several discoveries that distinguish integral from modern and postmodern, which I'll mention later, but here's a big one. Not to push a metaphor too far or to mix metaphors, but here it is. The fire is already burning. And lighting a fire, another fire, is both difficult and counterproductive. The flame is there inside. It's the itch of dissonance that emerges chronically and spontaneously. Traditional schooling, filling a bucket, fails to recognize that children construct their own knowledge. Modern and postmodern schooling improve education by taking that into account. But modern, postmodern schooling fails to recognize that dissonance occurs spontaneously in children over and over again, creating irresistible motivation to act. Integral schooling improves education by taking that into account. The guiding metaphor for integral schooling is thus, fan a flame that's already there. Don't try to light yet another fire. Fan a flame that's already burning. In addition, integral schooling addresses some practical problems that have surfaced in modern and postmodern schooling. For example, as I tried to illustrate a moment ago, even the most talented teachers cannot stimulate insights in 20 students simultaneously. It's like herding cats. The problem is made more difficult because each student is in a different state of interest, motivation, and readiness to construct the knowledge that the teacher prescribes at each moment. Each student's configuration of stages and lines of development is different. Curricular sequencing is a problem too. Different pathways work for different children. In practice, much of the time, modern, postmodern teaching falls back on traditional methods. The best you're likely to do in modern, postmodern, on average, is to maintain order, get a fire going occasionally in a few kids, and watch them grow up. And by and large, I think that's what most schools are doing. Integral schooling harnesses the chronic dissonance that's part of being human. Integral schooling also incorporates other findings that have been piling up. And that's what I want to take a look at now. In this last segment, I'll summarize findings and discoveries in recent decades that have not or cannot be effectively incorporated in modern and postmodern schooling. All of these findings are systematically incorporated in integral schooling. The question is, shall we upgrade our schools to a new version? And to be clear about my own view, I'm in favor of upgrading. We know that motivational dissonance occurs naturally. The flame is already there. We know that there are many kinds of smart, many lines of development. I want schools to facilitate broad growth across many lines. I don't want to see talented kids discouraged or stigmatized simply because their talents and intelligences lie outside the standard curriculum. Meta-learning is crucial. What is the child learning just by being in the system? From a student perspective, C-cubed, the curriculum classroom control model, that's a modern or postmodern school, is a rigidly controlled society ruled by a privileged class of administrators and teachers. That's what it looks like from a student's perspective sometimes. Students have little say in curriculum and in governance. The message to the student is disempowering and undermining. And it's not compatible with healthy community or American democracy. In a democratic school, students and adults govern together, and everyone shares responsibility for the well-being of the community. Intrinsic motivation enhances learning. Interest and control make all the difference. This has been well known for decades. It's true for everybody of all ages, not just children. You learn best when you choose to learn because you're interested or because you need it. Extrinsic motivation doesn't work. It inhibits learning. That's rewards and punishment. It might surprise you to learn that even praise can inhibit learning if it's experienced as manipulative or controlling. Optimal challenge. Kids tend to choose what's just out of reach developmentally for them. If you've read Vygotsky, then you might recognize this as related to the zone, the idea of the zone of proximal development. One size doesn't fit all. It's common and confirmed knowledge that children vary greatly in their favored learning modes, styles, and sequences. I hear this very often from parents and school teachers. Community is crucial, absolutely crucial. Fellowship, culture, shared responsibility. As Maslow's hierarchy illustrates, human beings need to belong and feel accepted before advancing to satisfy higher needs. And finally, imposed curriculum is harmful. And this one is so important. How does coercive curriculum harm you? One, it normalizes coercion, demonstrating that it's okay to coerce and manipulate. It clears the way for pecking orders and bullying. Two, it distracts you from better growth opportunities. It's crowding out the flame, is basically what it's doing. Three, it disempowers you by limiting your control of your life. Four, it fosters dependence on others, teaching you to wait for direction from a teacher, deadening your initiative. Five, it undermines self-awareness, including the ability to feel dissonance. Your self-awareness is irrelevant when there's a fixed prescribed curriculum. Your own interests and talents don't matter. Six, it conveys a very dangerous myth. Do as you're told and all will be well. Seven, finally and simply, coercion degrades the quality of life. It induces fear, alienation, and unhelpful stress. Nature impels us to avoid death and seek infinity. The first is the survival instinct, deeply rooted in our biology. Maslow's hierarchy suggests you must satisfy the first before you can do much about the second. If we feed, clothe, secure, and love our children, they are freer to pursue knowledge, understanding, wisdom, and high purpose. The second imperative, seek infinity, is instilled in us as the need to resolve dissonance, to get things just right, to strive. It's the subtle compulsion of the incomplete. It's why we rearrange the furniture in the living room. It's why we pursue hobbies, relationships, education, career. It leads us to joys and burdens, opportunities and challenges, adventures and misadventures. The path usually seems twisted, sometimes direct, and rarely predictable. We each blaze our own path together. How shall we school our children? Shall we simply design a new curriculum better suited to new frontiers? Shall we transmit that knowledge to children more efficiently with better technology? Shall we continue to select a handful of subjects and declare that what the world needs now is for all children to master these subjects, all at the same age, at the same time, in the same sequence, using the same methods? Or shall we instead say out loud what we all know and science now confirms? We are each different from one another in a host of ways. We each create a unique life, most satisfying when built on our own interests, hopes, talents, and values. Let's build on our agreements, acknowledge our layered world, create self-renewing schools, and welcome each moment as a creative advance into novelty, in the spirit of the pioneers we are. Thank you.